The next lecture is by Thierry Coquin.
Okay, thank you. So, so in this lecture, I want to present the first example, what was historically the first example of a dynamical method that was used for describing algebraic closure of a field in a prospective way. But before we start on this, so I have more to say about the structural shift. So I recall what I did last time. So I defined, given a commutative ring R, and to simplify, we take it to be an integral domain. So it's inside a field of fraction. It's field of fraction. And we defined in a point-free way, we defined what is known so classically as the Zariski spectrum of the ring. But constructively, what is a Zariski spectrum? It is a distributive lattice. So it was that's a constructive description of it. And it was described, it was defined with a universal property of the support. So I will not do this again. And on this lattice, seen as a space, we define a sheaf, which is a structure sheaf, so that's something like this. And we define it only on a basic open set. Okay, so we, and the definition was simple, so it's only the inverse, we inverse A. And this is inside the field of fractions if A is different from zero. So if A equals zero, then you have a problem, everything collapses. what happens classically, so you want to see this as a what's the classical view of this? So the classical view of this is as a family of ring which varies over the you have the spectrum, which is seen as a set of points. So a point is a prime filter, and over this this point, you have a ring, which is a local ring, where you localize in alpha. So you make all elements of alpha invertible. And so what is R alpha? R alpha is, so you take the inductive limit over R 1 over A for alpha member of the open. So that's the view, that's the classical view of this of this structure shape. So it's a family of rings that are local, which varies with alpha. And this spectrum, so it's, this sheaf, it's only defined on basic open. But if you want to define it on any open, so I mean that's standard, you can extend it. So if U is an open, what is an open? So it will be given by a collection of D of A. It's a union of D of A, or D of A subset of A. And FR of U will be defined, I hope it's right, as a projective limit. Over. So it's a projective limit of this for D of A inside U. So that's the classical definition. So I hope it's right, because in this way it's symmetric because between U and alpha. And so there, you have a complete definition of FR as a sheaf, and FR, as I said, is a sheaf, so it's a sheaf. So if D of A, if D of B is less or equal than D of A, actually, what you have, since R is a domain, R of A1 is a subset of R. Okay. So for A, B different from U. So, that's, so there is a map, restriction map is trivial in this case. And so how do you prove that it is a sheaf? So the proof actually is a proof of this. It's really the equality that you learn in high school, that, so if you have two fractions that are equal, that's, this is equal to A plus C over B plus B. Okay, so this is And you all know this this fact, and that's really, I mean, the essence of why it is a sheaf. That's nothing more than what it is a sheaf. So how do you check that you have a sheaf? You take, you assume D of A equals D of A1 D of N. Okay, and you have a, so what does that mean? That means that some power of A is a linear combination of so first you have a compatible family of elements. So you are given a compatible family of elements. So what is this? So you are given alpha I, which is in R1 over AI. Okay, and everything is in the field of fractions. So actually, the compatibility is simple, they are all equal. Oh yeah, so sorry, fix the point. Yeah. So UI, okay, so what is this element? It's a, it's a fraction, it's there, so it's of the form U, first one will be U1 A1 over N, for some N big enough. Okay, and you are, and they are all equal. That's a compatibility condition. So, and also for this N, you know that you have. so now I will. And I will cover only the case where you have a covering of the D of 1 to simplify. So let's look at this case. So you have one which is a sigma of VI AI to the N. Okay, because that's a definition, if you look at the definition of covering,
that's a grand N.
No, first you don't have grand N, but then. So first you have this. I mean, that's a that was the definition of what was a covering, and then from this follows that you have for WI you also have this with content. So I need content because okay, so how do you glue them together? You use this. Okay, so the gluing of these elements is the sigma WI over 1. So that's how you show that this is a sheaf.
Thierry?
Yep.
What do you mean by this fraction A plus C over B plus D?
So that's what you use. So you use that if A over B equals C over D, then A over B equals C over D equals A plus C over B plus D. Thanks. Yeah. So that's what I'm using here. So I have a collection of fractions that are all equal. So they are all equal to this combination. N, this is 1, sigma UI. So this is the gluing of this local data. I'm given some data and I glue them together. And this element is in R of FR of D of 1. So this is, and why it's interesting is because you have a so first you can define, yeah, so you have this, so in this sheaf model, so that's an example of, this is an example of a sheaf. Okay, and more generally, so if F is a sheaf, you can define, you can look at when is F a sub-singleton. So So it will be a subsingleton if all f of a, f of b of a, is a subset of 0. That's a special case of a subsingleton on the sheaf. And on this, so at this level of sheaves, you can define actually, so the what Martin presented yesterday, so this propositional quotation, it's easy to define in this way. So how do you define the propositional truncation of F? So V of F. Okay, so you so you have to be careful. So this will be, so the naive definitions will be you say this is empty so to simplify, I will assume that you can decide if f of d of a is empty or not. So this, so in general case where f is a set, okay, and to simplify, I assume I can decide if it's empty or not. And the naive definition of this will be that it is empty if f of d of a is empty, and it is zero if f of d of a is inhabited. So that's a naive definition, but if you do this, so you don't get a sheaf in general. Okay, because if it may be that you have a D of A which is covered by A1 AN, okay, and it may be that they are all inhabited, and then you cannot glue them together, because if this was if F of D of A was empty, then you have a problem. So what is the definition? So it's, this is wrong. Okay, so you say this is defined as zero. So this is a set of zero such that you have a covering B of A, B of A1. You can find the covering of B of A where each F of B of AI is non-empty. Okay, so that's the right definition of the support of the sheaf.
There exist.
And then you can start to play with this actually and check actually that so this is a subsingleton. You can check that it is a sheaf, but it was defined in a way, I mean, definition makes it a sheaf, and then you can check Martin's definition of propositional truncations, all the axioms that you presented, all for this definition.
You have no compatibility condition?
Yeah, and that's an important point. So you don't need any compatibility condition. So in general, so it might be, so that's the key point, that it may be that f of d of a is empty. Okay. But propositional truncation of f is not empty. So that's counterintuitive because intuitively this is supposed to be smaller than this one. You contract, but in this, this is a counterintuition. This phenomena you might have this. If I have time, I might present an example of this situation. Okay.
We'll ask Bruce the other one.
Sorry. Yeah. So I want to present example of local global property, but before, so I one example of use of intuitionistic logic. So you can ask, so in general, so phi will be a formula of the language of ring will be, so you look at the A, the set of A, so that A forces phi. Okay. So and this, so yesterday, so Matt was presenting in the other view of topological models. So when semantics of phi is seen as an open set, so there this will be the union of all V of A for the A for six phi. So now you can ask, so what is the meaning of not phi in this model? Okay, so if you have, so what does that mean that not phi is forced? Okay, and so classically, but it's only classically, so that's a good example. Look at the classical definition of this. It means exactly that this is not dense. So that's a good, really a good exercise. But it's only classically that it means this.
Depending on the definition of dense.
Yeah, so what do
you define an open subset to be called dense if and only if you have the following for any open subset. If the intersection with it is empty, then that a subset is empty, then that holds constructively.
Say it again. So this
open subset is dense if and only if the following holds. For any open subset B.
For me. I can limit to basic open?
Yes.
Yeah.
If the intersection of U and U of A is empty, then D of A is empty.
Then already D of A is
empty. Yeah.
Okay, so if you have this definition of dense subset, then this holds also intuitively.
Yeah.
And classically, this definition is the definition of dense.
Yeah.
Why I mentioned this is that because there is a nice application of this notion by Ingo Benschmidt. Okay, you look at the following situation. So you have M is a finitely generated module over R. Module over R. So it's a module which has a finite number of generators. Okay. And the surprising result is that in these forcing relations, so you have not, M is free. Really surprising results, because a module, R is not decided, the equality is not decidable, everything, so you cannot, how can you find extract of basis? Okay, and there is no intuitions why it has to be free. Okay, and this is actually, if you formulate it in this way, the proof is a trivial induction by on the number of generators of the module. So that's a really good exercise shift model, because the proof is two lines. So when you see this geometric way, the proof is two lines, but actually if you look it from a classical point of view, so that's so this is known as a botanic freeness lemma, generic freeness. You can look at it in Wikipedia and compare this proof with the proof in EGA. Okay, so in this Grothendieck and Dieudonné, so they assume the ring to be noetherian. R to be a domain and noetherian. Uh, and the proof is quite complex, but actually, so it holds, you don't need Noetherian. And if you look at it, so that's an application of logic. If you look at it with this, in this view, then the proof is. Sorry? The classical statement is that if R is a domain and Noetherian, then. I mean, this is this. So then the set of A, so if F is a finitely generated menu on R, so the set of union of D of A, so that M, so if you localize in A, is free on R 1 over A. This union is that. That's a density, generic density. In the Zariski, for the Zariski topology. Yeah, so, and one message of this presentation. So is that all this, so it uses notion of sheaves, and, but it's completely elementary. And you don't need everything is done in a very, very weak fragment. You don't need. It's not even PRA. You use nothing, almost nothing. Logic. So I said this semantics, so it was a best model. Okay, but actually, I mean, BET, you didn't have this this semantics. So it's not exact. So it's a generalization of the notion of BET model. So there are two. It's generalized in two ways. So first way that BET had only threes. Okay. So the spaces that you consider were of this form. Like this. That was the spaces that you consider. And also for BET, so the domain was not varying, so the domain, fixed domain. So it was semantics or first-order logic, and the domain was fixed. So people have generalized BET semantics to the varying domain. And generalization we have presented here, it's over a distributive lattice instead of over a tree. So it's not this side. But the main idea of this, so why I use the terminology best model, that because the main, main, what is the difference between best and filter semantics? It's when you interpret exist, okay? So for, in the filter semantics, so if you have this, so the witness exists that, witness has to exist, has to be there, at A, at level A, but for, so that's Kripke, but for BET, so you have this question of, this is that A is covered by elements, and then, by some elements, and the witness can exist later. And you have witnesses at all, at level, so you have C1 at level A1, Cn at level A. And they don't have, so what is important is that those witnesses don't have to be compatible. Okay. So, because if they are compatible, you can glue them together and you have a witness at stage A. But for, I mean, what's weird is that you have existence, local existence, but you may not have global existence. And the view of depth for this, it was with in terms of bar. So the notion of bar is the same as the notion of cover. So now you have, so what's very important in algebra, and it's notion of a local global property. So what is a local global property? So it's a property which, if it holds locally, it holds globally. So if so, I say that phi is for the first order formula, phi will be local global so whenever you have d of a which is covered by a1an, and you have a1 forces phi, an forces phi. Then you can conclude that A forces phi. Okay. I look only at, so all properties are monotone. So if B of B is given B of A, so you have A forces phi, you always have that A forces phi implies B forces phi. These are all monotone. So if it holds at some stage, it will hold later. Okay, that's a monotonicity property of cryptic semantics and depth semantics. But in general, you cannot, you don't have this property. Okay. So, yeah. And what is surprising is that a lot of properties actually are local global. Sorry, I made a mistake there. This is not what I mean. I mean, all properties are local global. So this is not the definition. Sorry. For forcing, so that if you have, so you look at phi and you ask phi holds for R 1 over A1. Phi holds. Want to conclude that phi holds for. So I will give examples. So I mean the example, first example was the exercise of that Henri presented yesterday. So it was the fact that if R is the prefer, then R is integrally closed. The proof, and we see. So I recall. So the argument. So we do the proof as if R was a valuation domain. So we start with X, which is A over B. Okay. So what is integrally closed? If X is integral over R, then X is already in R. So we assume, for instance, that we have X squared equals U1x to U2. Okay. That's an integral relation where U1, U2 are R. And we ask, so does this imply that x is an R of U? So what is the reasoning if R is a valuation domain? Okay, so if R is a valuation domain, then we have x in R or 1 over x in R. That's a definition of valuation domain. So we have A over B in R or B over A in R. Okay, so in this case, we have finished, x is in R. And in this case, what we do, so the trick is to use this and to write this as x equals u1 plus u2 over x. Okay, and 1 over x is in R, so this is in R also. And this is, so, this is in R. So in both cases, x is in R. So we'll take exactly the same proof, but no, we will use, so it's preferred, so it's only locally the valuation domain, and you will see the proof with this semantics, shift semantics, interpretation of this proof. So I want to take the same, same definition. So same proof, same argument, but no, so R is preferred only. So I have that X is in R of X, 1 over X is in R. Okay, so this is not true absolutely, but this is true in the sense of the shift model and with this shift model. And this was written as we have a covering of the space over which we have this or this. So what was the definition of the preferred domain is that we had, by definition, we have U and V, so that U plus V equal 1. That was, and locally, so and we have S and T, so A over V is S over U. And B over A is T over B. So locally, we have that B divides A or A divides B. So that's, and now I want to follow the same reasoning. So on this part, we have that A over B equals S over U. Okay. And on this part, so I will copy what I have there. I will x is equal to u1 plus u2 over x. I mean, I assume that x is root of x squared equal u1x plus u2. So I have this. So that means that a over b is equal to u1 plus u2 b over x. And u2 b over a is t over b, so this is u1a plus u2 t over b. So I have this and this two equality. Okay, and now I can use the shift property. So u plus v equal 1, so I get that a over b is actually equal to S plus U1A plus U2T over U plus B. Okay, that was the thing, lemma of fractions. And U plus B is 1, so this is S plus U1A plus U2T. Okay. So this belongs to R. So that's a reasoning shift interpretation of reasoning of the valuation domain. So that's an example of local global property. So if I have this, if each R1 over Ai is integrally closed, then R is integrally closed. What I have just shown in one example. So what are examples of local global property? So if you have an equation, a linear equation. So if we have a linear equation, a linear system of equation, so Ax equals b, and we want to solve it in a ring R, so then it has a solution. It has a solution in R, in a ring R. If and only if, it has a solution in all. So if we assume that we have a covering of the space, okay, so it has a solution in R, if and only if it has a local solution. So it has a solution in each. In each locally. Okay. So that's an example of a local global property. And this is used in algebra. So in algebra, so, and in this way you get nice algorithm where you solve a local solution and then you glue together the solution. Okay, but what is important there is that and this is crucial, I mean the solutions don't have to be compatible. Okay. So you can have solutions that are non-compatible solution. If the system is linear, you can glue them together.
Okay? That's, in fact, x and b can be in the module.
Yeah, and this you can solve in more generally, so a and b can be in a module.
X,
of the,
x and b.
A, sorry.
X and b can be
in x the and b, yeah. Can be in a module over R. That's a very, very general principle. Okay. But it is crucial that the system is linear. Because, so if the system is not linear, then nothing happens. So for instance, the property to be a square for an element A in R, you have an element U in R, and you ask, is U a square? Okay, so that will be a non-linear property. So that there exists x, u equal x. So this is a non-local global property because it might be that locally you have a solution, but you will not be able to glue together the solution. When you glue together a solution, you use linearity. So, what you will have, yeah. So, that's an example of a non-local global property. So, some properties are local global and some are not. And I think, so I don't know if it has been solved, Probably people have looked at this already, so I don't know, but question is so question which came out so when I was trying to present this, so is what are the first order local global properties? So an existential formula with a linear equation is local global. This formula is non-local global. Is there a simple syntactic description of the local global property? I don't know if this has been solved yet.
XY belongs to the identity X2.
So that's
a...
So here is an example which shows that this might be subtle. So this property of XY belongs to the ideal generated by X squared and Y squared. Okay, so that's a property which is first order. So given X and Y, so this is exist U exist V XY equal U x squared plus V x squared.
It is a form of
so this property is local global.
It's in form of the element, it's sure.
But maybe this is linear. Yeah, but it's an example of a local global property. And so another local global property. Yep.
Before you erase the boxes,
yep.
I think in the box, the second box, the last A should be a V.
So, the last, this one?
It doesn't matter as long as it's not something is real.
Okay, yeah. You want V?
Yep. Below is where?
And?
Below is where, but it doesn't matter. Yeah.
So an example of a non-first order local global property is so for a domain, so I define to be coherent. So it means that the intersection of two finitely generated ideal is finitely generated. It's a definition of of coherent. So this is a non-first order property because it's you say finitely generated is non. It's not first order. So this property is local global. So this is a local global property. And this is not so intuitive. Okay, so it means that in order to solve this problem, it's enough to find a covering of the space and to solve the problem locally. Not obvious. So this is proved in a book on constructive algebra by Henri and Claude. But why I want to show this is the difference between the constructive formulation of the local global property and the non-constructive formulation of local global properties that you find in textbook. So classically, how do you define the local global? Okay, you say that phi holds for R if it holds following R, if it holds for each localization, for R alpha, for all of R alpha, where alpha is a prime number. So alpha prime number. So that's the definition that you find in algebra. Okay, and that corresponds, I mean that, so you say something will hold all the space if it holds at all points of the space. And for this definition, so I mean for most examples, this definition is equivalent to the constructive definition. But for this property, so this doesn't hold for coherence. So coherence, to be coherent, is not a local global property for this classical definition. Okay, so I don't think I will have time to present the algebraic closure. So instead, I will end with a counterexample to countable choice, an algebraic counterexample to countable choice. So, I mean, yesterday, Matt presented some topological model where countable choice is not valid, and the usual example is over 0, 1. I mean, so if you take functions over 0, 1, so you have, if you take this real, okay, the functions embedding of 0, 1 in R, so this is a real which is not, it cannot be limit of a Cauchy sequence. Okay, so that's all, I mean, Dedekind real and Cauchy reals does not coincide for this. So that's the analyst presentation of model. And I want to show that you can do similar things in a purely algebraic way. So I want to present an example of a shift model which will look like the shift model we've been using, where countable choice doesn't hold.
For which theory?
For which theory?
You model it inside.
So it's a shift. So it's a shift model where countable choice doesn't hold. And I will only so present the example. Why I present this is because of the formulation of countable choice in when you have truncation, which is very elegant. So with truncation, using truncation, propositional truncation. You can formulate countable choice in the following way. So if you have for all n in n truncations of A of n, then you have a truncation of pi n of A of n. This is a surprising formulation of countable choice.
So the truncation you mean in the model is just the image of the topos?
Yes, so the truncation is the one I described in terms of, I describe what is propositional truncation. So I want to give, so the question is to find a simplest possible model where you don't have this property. And I think so this is an example. So I will end only by presenting this example. Giving proofs. So at first, I think, so it's over this poset. So this is a distributive lattice, one bounded. So so you have a unit, which is a dimension correspond to the total space, then this is covered by two elements, R0 and R1 and X0. So in this lattice, so you have X0 is sup of X1 and R1. Okay, you can take intersection of X1 and R1. So you get an element R2. Okay, so you get this lattice, and then you go on this side. So you have X2, X3. So that's the description of the lattice by generator relations. So in general, you have zero. Xn is xn plus 1, cn plus 1, and rn plus 1 is xn. So on this lattice, I claim that if you take the shifts on this space, the countable choice doesn't hold. So how do you define the so A of n will be of the form P of n plus Q of n. Okay, where P and Q are subsingleton. So are they conditions? So what's the semantics of P of so the semantics of Q of 0 will be the same as semantics of Q1. And this will be R1. Then for the semantics of so that's an open subset in this space. And then the semantics of P of 0 will be X1. Semantics of P of 1 will be X2 and so on. So let's look in this model. So what is the semantics of in this model? So if you look at the truncation of P of 0 plus Q of 0, okay. So that will be the sup. So it will be X1 sub R1. And this is the total space. So this the formula P of 0 or Q of 0 is true. And you have this for all n. You have the P of n or Q of n is true. Everything. So this formula will be true. But if you look at the semantics of this one, so if you look at for all n, in n, P of n plus Q of n. No, that's OR. So this OR is a truncation of the others. So the semantics of this will not be so exercise. This is different from X. And actually, this will be exactly this open set. So this is the algebraic version of this counter model of countable choice. And I wanted to present it because it's expressed in terms of it's expressed in terms of propositional truncation, which is subtle. Propositional truncation is quite subtle in shift models. So that's so that was what I wanted to show before presenting algebraically closed field. And I put the slides on the home page, and you can have a look at the slides, but in 5 minutes. time to present this, so I will stop here. Thank you.